Planetary protection, I sometimes equate to the national park rules. When you go there, you want to make sure you leave it in the same condition as when you found it.
And liftoff as the countdown to Mars continues.
After a successful launch from Florida, NASA's new Perseverance rover is on its way to the Red Planet. It's outfitted with cameras, lasers, sensors, even a helicopter, all tasked with decoding the planet's secrets. The centerpiece is a drilling system, designed to dig up samples of Martian dirt and prep them for a second mission, one that will return them to Earth for study. They're looking for hard evidence that Mars once harbored life, and that raises a whole new set of challenges. It means knowing what life might look like on Mars.
Most samples that contain signs of life may not be so obvious.
Where to find it, how to collect it.
We actually drill to about typically 70 millimeters down.
And it means keeping life from doing what it does best, popping up uninvited.
It might be that very quickly, life just goes everywhere.
Can you give us an overview of the concept of planetary protection?
For planetary protection, when we're exploring places like Mars and other bodies that may harbor life, we have to make sure that we do it in a way where we don't spread Earth-based contamination to that environment. There's also a flip side to that. If one day we bring samples back, we have to make sure we protect Earth from those samples as well.
Planetary protection is so important because of the end game this mission is teeing up, Mars sample return.
The Mars sample return will include the first ever rocket launched from another planet.
Most scientists agree, we're unlikely to identify microbial life with any instruments we can fit on a rover. We have to bring the rocks to us. That's why Perseverance's biggest mission is collecting samples, using a complex drilling system, robotic arms, and specially designed bits. If all goes well, Perseverance could fill up to 43 titanium sample tubes with dirt, hermetically seal them, and store them for later.
And it's sort of this wide-ranging capability that makes it a little difficult, right? In order for you to go and drill into rocks on another planet, you build a fairly beefy drill, but I also have to design it for really delicate operations. And so, how, you know, where do you have to get that nice balance in there, right? And so it's pretty fun.
And why is it so important specifically when it comes to the samples that they have to be extra clean? Why do we need to go through all of these precautions?
So in particular for Perseverance, we have to make sure that the parts, the tools that are acquiring the sample are extremely clean, actually sterile, because when we collect that sample, we have to make sure when we open it up and we interrogate it for possible ancient microbial life that we don't say, hey, big newsflash, we found life on Mars, and come to find out it's actually something that hitched a ride from Earth.
Tell me about all the precautions that you had to do with the sampling system.
Yeah, so we have taken several precautions, even to the design of the tubes that will hold the Martian samples. We designed it in a way so that it would not be recontaminated after we clean it. We also expose it to a really high temperature process, so 150 degrees Celsius for 24 hours minimum.
They also swabbed it all over, looking for microbial hitchhikers.
DNA is a really good way to understand what is on the surface of the spacecraft without having to grow it up on a petri dish. No matter what is there, as long as the signal is high enough, you can detect it. And we are using that list to have kind of a passenger list of things that could potentially be on the spacecraft surface.
Now, one thing I've learned about when it comes to planetary protection and sending spacecraft to other worlds is that the microbes on Earth are resilient.
Yes.
So is there still going to be some kind of living organisms on this vehicle that we just can't help and they're just gonna hitch a ride no matter what we do?
The golden standard that we use for, like, this is the worst case thing that we would find on the spacecraft, we use what we call bacterial endospores. So these are microbes that can go into a dormant-like state and survive for millions of years. So we target these because it is the golden standard of the hardest thing on Earth to get rid of. But that knowledge changes over time. We thought it was a different microbe in the past, and now we found something even hardier. So yes, life here on Earth is resilient, and we're consistently and continuously looking for something else that'll challenge our threshold of what that is.
All these procedures will help to ensure that when we get the samples back to Earth, they'll be as purely Martian as possible. That way, the hunt for ancient life can begin. scientists will be looking for biosignatures, materials they think might have come from past life. For Perseverance, that means looking for minerals and rock formations that are associated with microbes here on Earth.
Geologists often use the word texture for shape in a rock. Lifelike textures together with lifelike compositions. So that's chemical compositions, in the elements that are important to life on Earth, organic matter, obviously, the molecules that are important to life, but also the minerals that are important to life.
It also means digging up rocks and materials that are really good at preserving fossilized bacteria on our planet.
It can be rocks that that contain, say, a lot of silica, something that is similar to what occurs in modern day, say, Yellowstone National Park. Silica is just a very good material. It has very, very fine grains. So tiny, they're smaller than a microbial cell. And so silica is really good at preserving the shapes of microbial cells.
Let's say that Mars was abundant in microbial life back in the day. Do you think that's something that we'll be able to see in these samples?
So life is everywhere on Earth. Everywhere we drill into rocks, as deep as we have ever drilled, when you bring rocks out, there are cracks in those rocks where there's water in the cracks and you find microbes there. So it might be that when life emerges on a planet, if there are widely distributed habitable environments, it might be that very quickly life just goes everywhere. You know, it finds a way, like Jurassic Park, you know. Or it could be that the conditions on Mars were always much harsher than they ever were on Earth, and that life could have gained a foothold, but only just barely, you know, and it could have been very patchily distributed around the surface of Mars. We really don't know.
Perseverance's destination is Jezero Crater, NASA's best guess for a spot that was once full of life. It's a massive barren basin, but billions of years ago, it was a flowing river delta that fed into a lake.
If there were microbes in that lake, they had every opportunity to colonize, especially, say, the edge of the lake, where you often find pond scum on Earth, where those sediments in the lake interact with the gooey microbial stuff and form these, ultimately, these layered rock types that we call stromatolites, basically fossilized pond scum. They can easily survive for billions of years. That's like our holy grail.
Perseverance is just the first step in this project. Europe is leading the charge on a follow-up mission. It would send another spacecraft to Mars to scoop up these samples, blast them off the surface, and return them to Earth. That will be when the flip side of planetary protection kicks in. Scientists will also need to check for any live Martian organisms that hitched a ride, however unlikely that may be. All of the Martian hardware will have to be contained in some way from the moment it touches down on Earth.
Ultimately, it's very tightly sealed up in an Earth entry capsule that's designed to really actually hit the surface of Earth without even a parachute, so that we can be absolutely confident that even without a parachute, it wouldn't break open and inadvertently release any of that stuff.
It's a process that could take up much of the next decade, but it's already given planetary protection experts plenty to think about.
I feel like this is just kind of the ultimate test of planetary protection, right? Because you're going forward and you're coming back. So what does it feel like to be a part of this mission as a planetary protection expert and getting to test out basically every rule there is when it comes to this this concept?
We're really breaking new ground with this Mars sample return campaign. And it feels, I feel so small in a good way, right? In the context of this large mission, it's kind of like there are a lot of jobs that are somewhat thankless. And if I do my job right, you won't hear about me, right? I don't want to hear planetary protection did a poor job and we found life that hitched a ride. No, when you don't hear about me, then I know it was a success. So I'd be happy for the lack of praise.